So again, I want to thank Kathy. I want to thank Ron for the invitation. I was actually at Beijing and then at Washington, D.C., and then here. So I just got here. But thank you again for the invitation. So I'm going to talk about what we've been working on in our lab for the past, I would say, 7 or 8 years, specifically with regard to how we use iPS cells for disease modeling. I'm a cardiologist, so most of our work will be related to cardiovascular disease. So this is my disclosure slide right here. And I want to point out that you know, most of us have heard about the Precision Medicine Initiative, which, you know, as President Obama says, is trying to deliver the right treatment at the right time, every time to the right patient, to the right person. I think a lot of the PMI initiative has traditionally been focused on cancer genetics, trying to understand the genetics of cancer and then therefore coming up with the targeted therapy. I think for other diseases, for example, for cardiovascular diseases, I would make the argument that it's actually much difficult, as shown by this slide here. And this is that it's much more difficult just by DNA sequencing the patient to predict what's going to happen to our patient. And so in part of the reason why and there's a missing link of the genotype, the phenotype study is that I think, as you all know, for most common diseases, there are hundreds of genetic risk variants with very, very small effects. And therefore, again, it is very difficult to develop a clear picture of what's going to happen to our patients just by DNA sequencing them. The other reason is that, you know, there's a complex world of epigenomics, transcriptomics, metabolomics, environmental omics that are not traditionally captured by DNA sequencing somebody here. And I would say for a clinician like me, who's a cardiologist, ideally what we want to do is study the patient's heart in response to some kind of treatment. But we can't in the past because we just don't have access to these tissues. You know, one of the things I want to bring to attention is, you know, does it really make much sense to study peripheral biomarkers, for example, blood samples to look at heart disease, study blood samples to look at brain disease, study blood samples to look at liver disease. Wouldn't it be much better if you can directly access the patient's organs? But as I mentioned, you can't because of the inaccessibility of many of these organs. And I think this has now changed with this iPSL model, which I'm going to discuss about for the rest of my talk. So I assume most of you are familiar with iPSLs, but for a few of you who's not familiar with iPSLs, Shina Yamanaka from Kyoto, Japan, essentially discovered iPSLs back in 2006, 2007, received the Nobel Prize in medicine in 2012. You can take patient's blood or skin or fat or urine epithelial cells, hit them with four reprogramming genes, and create these patient-specific iPS cells that for all practical purposes are the same as your own embryonic stem cells, okay? And once you create these iPS cells, you should be able to generate brain cells, heart cells, liver cells, and so forth, because again, these are essentially the same as ES cells. And as you know, when a patient, when your mother's egg and your father's sperm fertilize, it becomes you. So the embryonic stem cells has to have the ability to become all the different organs and all the different tissues in your body. And so what this technology then allows you to do is you should be able to take iPS cells, for example, from everybody in this room, and assuming some of you may have some diseases, we should be able to do disease modeling. We should be able to give you medications and figure out which medications it's going to benefit and which medications not going to benefit. There's cell transplantation, autologous cell transplantation, which I won't go over because of time. You should be able to think about doing this in a clinical trial in a dish model as well. And then lastly, you should be able to think about doing this for a patient stratification. So we've been working on developing cardiomyocytes for the past 10 years or so, shown here different methods for making these human ESL and human iPSL cardiomyocytes. For sake of time, I won't go over the specific protocols, but in essence, most of our lab is trying to figure out what kind of factors do you need to add, what kind of differentiation or cardiac specification factors and what time point to push them into cardiomyocytes as shown here. The other approach in the lab is trying to make these cardiomyocytes in a high throughput and low cost production method. And this is a study done by one of my previous postdocs, Paul Burridge, who's now at Northwestern University, in which we came up with this CDM3 cocktail. And this media has a basal media, RPMI, L-ascorbic acid, and human recombinant albumin. And this media allows you to make iPS cells at a much lower cost because compared to the commercially available media, which is going to cost you about $300 per bottle, we can now make this media at about a cost of $50 to $60 a bottle. And once you're thinking about the mass scale production of these iPSL cardiomyocytes, this is quite essential. The other advantage of this media is that we actually don't use fetal bovine serum, so there's no animal product involved. And if you're thinking about clinical trials involving injection of these cells, you want to avoid as much as xenogenic product as much as possible. So now, again, we're able to make chemically defined generation of human cardiomyocytes at a pretty reliable method. And this slide kind of shows you how much has progressed. So I started my lab at Stanford in 2004. At that time, we were interested in making cardiomyocytes from human embryonic stem cells because, again, iPSL came about in 2006-2007. And here you can see this is a embryo body. You can see something twitch right here. These are the cardiomyocytes. What the problem we had was that 12 years ago, none of these cells here were twitching, and these cells could be nervous system cells, liver cells, and other cell types. So essentially, we were getting about 5% differentiation. And then after about 12 years of work, instead of using human ear cells, we now routinely take patient's blood. From 10 cc's of blood, we can make your iPS cells. And from your iPS cells, we can make tons and tons of your cardiomyocytes. Essentially, we can do mass production. It's pretty routine for us to make a run of 200 million iPS cell cardiomyocytes at about 90% efficiency. We can also do 2D micropatterning, as well as 3D tissue engineering of these human iPSL cardiomyocytes. This is a single iPSL cardiomyocyte. You can see the nucleus here. You can see the sarcomere, nice striation of the cardiomyocyte. This is a what we call a beef jerky. It's essentially a chunk of muscles generated by iPSL cardiomyocytes attached to two posts. This chunk of muscle is contracting, and this allows us to calculate the contractile force, the diastolic relaxation, and also in response to different medications, the arrhythmogenicity from this patch here. Now, keep in mind that the cardiomyocytes that we generate are not exactly the same as adult cardiomyocytes. They are different in terms of the morphology. They're slightly different in terms of the electrophysiology, slightly different in terms of the conduction velocity, in terms of calcium handling, mitochondrial bioenergetics. Now, this applies to pretty much all iPSL derivatives, whether it's iPSL brain cells, liver cells, endothelial cells. They're slightly different compared to the adult human derivatives. And I think it depends on what camp are you, meaning that if you're in this camp here, glass is half empty, you say this is not good enough, stop bothering with this work. And in fact, you know, most of the time when my grant gets rejected, essentially the reviewer just say these cells are not good because they're not adult cardiomyocytes. But I would say that we're in this camp. These are, it's good enough for us. It's half full. It's good enough for us to proceed. When I asked a postdoc who just joined my lab, do you want to spend the next 5 years working on mouse neonatal cardiomyocytes or spend the next 5 years working on human iPSL cardiomyocytes and trying to improve it? I think 100 out of 100 will always tell me that they want to work with the human iPSL cardiomyocytes instead of mouse and neonatal cardiomyocytes. Now, once you generate these cardiomyocytes, you should be able to do quite a bit of disease modeling. In this case here, I kind of listed some of the diseases that I'll touch a little bit upon. For example, long QT disease, CPVT, ARVD. These diseases actually cause some kind of death, hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, and dilated cardiomyopathy. And I'll give you a few examples of how we do this. So this moves into the second part of my talk. How do we do genotype, phenotype? And again, I emphasize that genotype, phenotype, iPSL platform, meaning that just by genotype alone, it's a lot of times it can't tell you what's going on with the phenotype. So you need integration of these three platforms to elucidate disease mechanism. So one example is this particular family here. The mother is shown by the black circle and eight kids, and kids 1, 2, 3, and 8 by DNA sequencing have myosin heavy chain 7 mutation with arginine to histidine switch. And then the phenotype is shown by the MRI thick septum right here. So the patient asks you, doc, you know, how does this mutation cause the hypertrophic cardiomyopathy? How does this mutation cause arrhythmia in these patients? And I think traditionally in the past, you would create transgenic mouse, and if the mouse manifests the hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, you can get a nice Cell Science Nature paper out of it. If the mouse does not manifest the cardiomyopathy, you're stuck, and you basically just move on to another project. And now we can actually just make iPSL cardiomyocytes from the entire family and try to elucidate how does this particular mutation causes the hypertrophy and also causes the arrhythmia. And so about 5 years ago, we made iPSLs in the entire family. And we showed that the hypertroph patient, the siblings that have the mutation, the iPSL cardiomyocytes have much bigger cell size compared to the siblings that do not have the mutation. This is a cell size quantification. There's also more multinucleation right here. You can aggravate this hypertrophy of the cell by giving the patient cells with isobutanol. We also show that there's increased nuclear translocation of the MFAC signaling pathway, consistent with the activation of the calcineurin pathway. And you can come in with calcineurin inhibitors such as cyclosporin A and FK506 to partially reverse the hypertrophic phenotype. So this is one readout, and I'll come back to the theme of readout, readout, readout if you're trying to use this for a drug discovery. So one readout we consistently see is hypertrophic cardiomyopathy patients have bigger cell size. The other readout that we saw is that these cells also have more arrhythmias, and this is control cells. These are hypertroph patients. They have much more DADs, and these are delayed after depolarization. Could be a setup clinically for VTV, fib, and torsade. We're very certain the mutation is causing the arrhythmia because when we introduce the wild type into a normal human ESL line, we do not see any arrhythmia. On the other hand, when we introduce the mutant arginine to histidine into the wild-type human ESL, we saw the arrhythmia, and these are the irregular calcium transients. So this is the second readout. The first readout is hypertrophy. The second readout is arrhythmia. And once you establish these readouts, you can come in with drugs. In this case here, we use a calcium channel block of verapamil to block the cellular hypertrophy and also block the cellular arrhythmia in these iPSL cardiomyocytes. And this is a big cell size after treatment with the verapamil. You can see shrink. These are irregular calcium transients. And again, after treatment with the verapamil, it shows a decrease of the regular calcium transients. And these are delayed after depolarization. And again, after treatment, you see a decrease here as well. Now, the paper has already been published. I'm not going to go over all the experiment, the details that we did. But suffice to say, we're very confident that the mutation, myosin heavy chain 7 mutation, is causing increased intracellular calcium, which leads to calcium handling defects. The MFAT activation causes hypertrophy. The hypertrophy is aggravated by giving them isobutanol. In the paper, we treated these cells with propranolol to block both the arrhythmia and also block the hypertrophy. We also treat the patient cells with lidocaine, mesylatine, and vinylozine to block the arrhythmia. And I'll show you how we treat it with the verapamil to block the calcium irregularity there. So this is one example. And hypertroph cardiomyopathy, that's the number one cause of inherited cardiomyopathy, accounts for about 1 in 500 patients. Another common cause of cardiomyopathy is a dilated cardiomyopathy. This is probably the most common cause of heart transplant in young kids. And in this particular family here, this kid had a heart transplant at age 14. The father also has dilated cardiomyopathy. Uncle has it. The grandmother also has it, so we know it runs in the family. It's familial dilated cardiomyopathy. Again, we did DNA sequencing. It's a troponin T mutation with the arginine to tryptophan switch. And then we asked a question, how does this particular mutation cause the phenotype that we saw? And so we found that these iPS cell cardiomyocytes from the disease cells had autoregulation of the calcium ion, decreased contractility, and abnormal distribution of the sarcomere alpha actinin. And you can treat it, exacerbate it with isoproterenol, and you can treat it with the metoprolol as well. Now, keep in mind that once we recruit these patients in our biobank, essentially these cells are for us, with us for the next 5, 10, 20 years. It's very different from a clinical trial in which a patient comes in and out, and once they leave the Bay Area, you can't find them anymore. So once we have that these cells, there's nothing that prevents us from doing a deeper dive and deeper pass at the exact mechanism. And here, Howdy Wu, another postdoc in the lab, was able to show that the mutant troponin T actually translocates into the nucleus, binds to histone demethylase enzymes, KDM5A and KDM1A, which increases phosphodiesterase, which increases phosphodiesterase 3A and 2A, increases the hydrolysis of cyclic AMP, and decreased level of cyclic AMP causes decreased protein kinase A, which leads to decreased calcium transient and decreased contractility of these iPSL cardiomyocytes generated from this particular family with the troponin T mutation. So more recently with Jeff Morkenton's group, as well as Quick Simon's group, Jeff's group was able to generate a whole series of transgenic mouse models in which he was able to alter the amount of sarcomeric stress, as well as alter the amount of the calcium being released from the plasma reticulum, which accounts for the cardiac thickening, as well as the dilatation right here shown by this cartoon. And all these data were actually confirmed by using iPSL cardiomyocytes that I showed you earlier that we generate from hypertrophic cardiomyopathy patients and also from the dilated cardiomyopathy patients. Now, besides hypertrophic and dilated cardiomyopathy, the third most common cause of cardiomyopathy is actually left ventricular non-compaction. This cardiomyopathy happens quite often in young adults and young pediatric kids. So Kazuki Koto, who's now assistant professor at Keio University in Japan in pediatric cardiology, was able to recruit a large family at Stanford and also another family in Japan. For this particular family at Stanford, the kid here already had a heart transplant at age 6, and he has two siblings that also has left ventricular non-compaction. You can see the ventriculum, the explanted heart, you can see the hypertrophication right here. And essentially, it becomes a very spongy myocardium here. We did the DNA sequencing. It's a TBX20 mutation. We're able to show that one of the mutations is a missense mutation. Another mutation is a truncation mutation. And the mutation in the TBX20 actually causes the iPSL cardiomyocytes to hyperproliferate, and that when we do genome editing to correct the mutation, you can see that the proliferation of these early iPSL cardiomyocytes resemble the control iPSL cardiomyocytes. By the RNA sequencing, we show the culprit is probably in a TGF-beta. And so what we think in this particular family, the mechanism is that the TBX20 mutation causes increased TGF-beta, which increases cell cycle regulators. Increased cell cycle regulators essentially screws up the ventricular myocardium specification and growth shown by this diagram here. So these are the cardiomyopathy patients that we've done. We've also done it in long QT. We actually have a very robust program with the long QT disease in collaboration with Don Burrs, Martin McCullough, and several other faculty at Stanford and also outside of Stanford. I just want to point out that right now, instead of just doing iPS cells from patients, we can actually do genome editing of these iPS cells. So that this is for example, this is a healthy patient. This is a healthy patient. This is a patient with long QT1, And we could take this healthy patient, the genome edit the same mutation, so that this healthy patient now has long prolonged action potential duration as shown here. The advantage here is that instead of recruiting patients, you can just tell me what kind of disease you want to study, and we just genome edit and then create these isogenic lines. And then from these isogenic lines, we can then do drug screening here. Now, keep in mind that for most of our patients in our clinic, the clinical scenario is actually much, much, much more complicated than the ones I showed you earlier with the troponin T mutation, the myosin heavy chain 7 mutation, the TBX20 or the long QT1 or long QT2 mutation. For example, this particular family that we saw in our clinic, the father and mother are fine. They do not develop. They do not have any cardiomyopathy phenotype. They have five kids. Kids one and two already had a heart transplant. Kid number three already had a left ventricular assist device. Kid number four have LV hypertrophication. And kid number five, the youngest one, is so far healthy. Through DNA sequencing, you can see a whole bunch of mutations right here. Some of them is likely pathogenic. Some of them is vast variant of uncertain significance. And so this gets very, very complicated in terms of trying to sort out what's going on. So a lot of in our lab, we have a big effort of taking iPS cells and essentially introducing each one of these variants to the iPS cells, or introduce combination of two or combination of three, and trying to determine what is the effect of each one of these variants here. And so this boils down to this question that we have. That, for example, clinically, you may see somebody in your clinic with, 25-year-old lady who passed out. Her sister also passed out. Her EKG may show QT, correct the QTC of, say, 480 prolonged, but not so severe. You don't know what to do with the patient, because when you send it out for gene DX, it comes back as a VUS. And the question is, can you make iPS cells? And from these iPS cells, if these iPS cells are very susceptible, for example, to arrhythmogenic medications, such as dofetilide or sotalol or other medications, compared to healthy cells, do you have more confidence that this is actually a pathogenic VUS? And do you have more confidence if you genome edit into a normal line with the same VUS and show the same phenotype? And do you have more confidence if you genome edit out this particular VUS and show that the phenotype disappear? So we don't have the data, and we're working on this question, but this is something that we think are very exciting, because I can kind of see that how we can accelerate the patient diagnosis by using a combination of genome editing as well as a VUS. The third part of my talk is how we use this genotype-phenotype iPSL platform for precision cardiovascular medicine. This is a very interesting slide, because essentially it shows for the top 10 medications that are used in the U.S., anywhere from blue shows that the medication works, and red shows that the medication does not work. So for a lot of these medications, anywhere from 3 to 24, in which the patients who took the medication essentially has no effect at all. And this is the reason why the title of the article is "It's Time for One-Person Clinical Trial." So I'm going to show you how, we're thinking about doing this for iPSL cardiomyocytes for cardio-oncology. Breast cancer is the second leading cancer death in women, with more than 12 million cancer survivors in the U.S. About 8% of them would develop acute doxorubicin-induced cardiotoxicity. Among the survivors, 20% would develop heart failure over 5 years, and 40% would develop heart failure if there's a combination of doxorubicin, Herceptin, and more than 75 years old. So the moral of the story is, you may survive the cancer, but you end up with heart failure later on. And the current treatment guideline is that, we'll give the patients beta blocker plus or minus ACE inhibitors once the echocardiogram shows reduced LVEF. And the question is, is this considered cardiovascular precision medicine? So more recently, we did a study here. And again, this study was done by Paul as well, in which we recruited breast cancer patients who were treated with the doxorubicin. And then we segregated into patients who had normal cardiac function and patients who had doxorubicin-induced cardiomyopathy. And we differentiate the iPS cell cardiomyocytes and then expose them to a whole bunch of assays that I showed you earlier that we've developed in our lab: contractility assay, calcium cycling metabolism, gene expression, apoptosis assay. And this is the patient phenotype. These are four healthy patients, four patients, breast cancer patients who received doxorubicin but did not develop any toxicity, and four breast cancer patients who received doxorubicin and developed cardiac toxicity. You can see here, for example, this is a 31-year-old woman, otherwise healthy, received doxorubicin. Her ejection fraction went from 70 down to 45. So we made iPS cell cardiomyocytes and from these cohorts, and the same dose of the doxorubicin, we can see that the dox-tox group had much more toxicity compared to the dox. This is a sarcomere staining right here. Likewise, the dox-tox group at the same dose had much more apoptosis compared to the healthy and the dox group. The same dose right here, 1 micromolar, the dox-tox group essentially stopped by beating compared to the dox group. So the point here is, even though I do not understand the genetics, I don't know the variants that could account for the cardiac toxicity, the iPSL cardiomyocyte is kind of agnostic. It essentially captures the DNA, the RNA, the proteins, and it's showing you the phenotype. And we can recapitulate the phenotype by using these assays that we've developed. The other thing that you should be thinking is that once you have these human iPSL cardiomyocytes, you know, you should be able to develop some kind of screening to see what kind of drug can be used to improve survival of these cells. And so this is in collaboration with a local startup company in which we screen for 10-plus medications, and we compare to dexazosan, which is the FDA-approved medication for protecting doxorubicin-induced cardiac toxicity. And out of these 10 medications, we found two, in particular one medication, SC018, compared to dexazosan. You know, it prevents cell death in response to doxorubicin. There's a there's a protection against mitochondrial damage. There's a protection against contractility, reduces double-stranded DNA breaks, and also has no effect on cancer killing. So we're very excited about the data because we really think that this platform that allows you to do high-throughput drug screening in the future, looking at medications that can be used to prevent doxorubicin. The other project that we have been working on for the past 3 to 4 years is using this as a tyrosine kinase inhibitors and see what is the effect on the iPSL cardiomyocytes. So listed here are some of the TKIs that are used clinically, and you'll see that they can be used, for example, for pancreatic cancer, thyroid cancer, breast cancer, and so forth. This is probably one of the most, if not the most popular class of medications for cancer patients these days. Many of these medications have cardiac toxicity, including tachycardia, congestive heart failure, QT interval prolongation. And so in collaboration with Jarvid at Vanderbilt University, we've been taking iPSL cardiomyocytes from patients and differentiating the cardiomyocytes, exposing them to a different classes of these medications as shown here. And what we're trying to do is to develop a cardiac safety index, or TKIs. Essentially, these are the medications, and these are the reported clinical toxicities. And this is what we saw in the iPSL in a dish, and trying to correlate how well they correspond to the clinical reported toxicity. So this work is still in progress, and hopefully we can present the data later on in a couple years. The next topic I'm going to discuss is how do we use a genotype phenotype iPSL platform to help drug development. And this is actually an interesting slide. So everyone have heard about Moore's law. In essence, you know, every two years, the computer chips speed increased by half. This is Eram's law. Essentially, every 7 to 8 years, the number of drugs approved by the FDA actually decreases by half. So they kind of ironically call this Eram's law. And as you all know, it costs a lot of money, 12, 16 years, $1 to $2 billion on average to get a drug to the new market. And the question is, can we use these iPS cells to help us with this? This is a slide by Pfizer, in which what they're thinking is doing a massive scale production of iPSL cardiomyocytes from, for example, from 3,000 patients. And from these iPSL cardiomyocytes, generally your brain cells, liver cells, heart cells, and endothelial cells develop some kind of assay. I've already told you assays for cardiac contractility, for arrhythmia, for metabolism, and so forth. And I've already kind of shown an example of how we use this particular assay to come up with drugs that are cardioprotective after doxorubicin-induced cardiotoxicity. And then based on these assays, compare cohorts. Cohorts means, you know, what is the difference between healthy and patients with a particular cardiovascular disease? What is the difference between men and women? And what is the difference, for example, among Caucasians, Asians, Hispanics, African Americans? So this is quite an exciting area of research. recently we did a study in which we went after low-hanging fruit, which is to use iPSL cardiomyocytes to show major ethnic differences in East Asians. And a lot of East Asians, as you may know, have this aldehyde dehydrogenase 2 genetic polymorphism. Accounts for the fact that when they drink alcohol, you know, you get facial flushing. Actually, myself included, if I drink alcohol, I get facial flushing. I get tachycardic. So it's very hard for me to be a alcoholic because I just can't drink too much. It's also a good protective gene because I actually don't need to exercise. I just drink half a glass and my heart rate shoots up and it stays up and then comes down in about half an hour. I take advantage of this as well. And but joking aside, in Asia, they've shown, for example, in Korea and Japan, in China, Taiwan, they've shown that patients with this particular genetic polymorphism, when they get a heart attack, they tend to have a worse outcome than patients who don't. And we tried to figure this out. And so we recruited Stanford undergrads, and these are the wild types. So that means these are Stanford undergrads who are Asian Americans. They can drink alcohol, no problem. These guys get the same feeling, tachycardia and facial flushing. We make the iPSL cardiomyocytes, expose them to the same amount of stress. You can clearly show that with the same amount of stress, the wild type have much less cell death compared to the heterozygous. And so essentially the wild type, it can tolerate the stress much, much better than the heterozygous mutant. So this kind of makes sense because if you lack this enzyme, you can't detoxify alcohol, but you also cannot detoxify ROS. And once you get a heart attack, there's tons and tons of ROS that get activated as well. So this is one example, and I kind of call this a low-hanging fruit because I kind of have a guess that this would actually work. And so right now we're working on several other projects. What about the African Americans with hypertension? Meaning that if you take iPSL endothelial cells, can you see a difference between African Americans who have resistant hypertension versus African Americans who don't? What about Hispanics with a diabetic vasculopathy? What about South Asians with metabolic syndrome? And again, when you make iPSL endothelial cells, do you see decreased nitric oxide? Do you see decreased tubule formation? And can you help them by giving them some kind of medication, for example, statin and so forth? The other concept is this concept that's put forth by Shina Yamanaka, which is, you know, as you all know, for these large clinical trials, a lot of times it's big and the data comes back to be negative and the investors lose interest, the drug companies lose interest. People do subgroup analysis to show some kind of positive data here and there. But cardiologists are pretty smart. We never believe in these subgroup analysis because we just call them as cherry picking. And so the question is, can you do reverse the study design in which you actually make iPSL cardiomyocytes, and from these cardiomyocytes or brain cells or endothelial cells, expose them to medications, and based on this, figure out which one of these cells respond and which one of these cells do not respond. And then for your initial clinical trial, you purposely cherry pick the ones that's going to respond. So essentially, you enroll the patients who already have a positive response based on the iPSL endothelial cell and iPSL cardiomyocyte signal. And based on that, you then challenge them with medications. And, you know, hopefully you get a positive data. That's a smaller trial. You know, once it's positive, then you then gradually expand the indication. So this is what a lot of people are thinking about, including our lab. And so more recently, we did a study using RNA-seq to show that there's patient-specific human IP cell cardiomyocyte can be used to predict drug safety and drug efficacy response in vitro. Essentially, what this slide is showing you is that we made iPS cell cardiomyocytes from five different patients. Each one of the patients, we created two different clones and differentiated the cardiomyocytes, and we do RNA-seq. And we can see that this is patient three, for example, this is patient one, patient five, and this is patient four. So what this slide is telling you is that the inter-individual heterogeneity is much, much bigger than the intra-individual heterogeneity. So most of the differences that we see when the iPSL cardiomyocytes is actually due to the genetic difference. It's much less due to the differentiation difference. It tells you that the differentiation protocol that we have is getting better and better, so there's minimal variability, and that most of the difference is actually due to the genetic difference. This slide here shows that we made iPSL cardiomyocytes from three diseased patients, in which we also had access to their hearts, and their hearts were actually turned down as heart donors. And then when we compared the iPSL cardiomyocytes to their hearts, they actually correlate quite well here as well. And then what we did with those five patients, we treated them with different medications. We also genome edit these cells. And essentially, what we're trying to do, long story short, is we're trying to take patients and make iPSL cardiomyocytes and do RNA sequencing of the gene expression profile to see how they respond, shown here, and then hopefully go back to the patient to tell the patient what medication they should be taking and what medication they should not be taking. So at the Stanford Cardiovascular Institute, we're creating a bank of about 1,000 iPS lines for drug discovery. We're at about 400 lines right now from 400 different patients. They have different cardiovascular history, different ethnicity, sex, and we routinely perform DNA-seq and RNA-seq on them. We also, working with the Russ Almond's group, we link it to the PharmGK database. We also have the STRIDE database so that each patient we know their clinical information. And we're working with NHLBI and CIRM on the iPSL biobanking, and also working with FDA on drug safety testing here. And we also established a very robust sharing plan with many investigators. In essence, if you ask us for these cells, we'll send you these cells free of cost. And again, I emphasize free of cost, you just pay for the shipping costs. So we're happy to send you these cells. If you have patients that you need us to make iPSLs and we don't have these patient cohorts, we're happy to make the iPSLs and send it back to you again free of cost. And this is my email right here. You're welcome to contact me. And so just want to summarize, this is my last slide. So what I kind of show you is how we can take iPSLs, and from these iPSLs we can do disease modeling, we can do personalized medicine, we can do drug discovery, and we can create an iPSL biobank that we distribute across the country and across around the world. And I didn't have a chance to talk about cell therapy. I just want to acknowledge the postdocs in my lab, the cardiology fellows, the instructors in the lab, the graduate students and the biobank staff, my collaborators at Stanford, my collaborators outside of Stanford, shown here, and then funding support from CIRM, from the NIH, from the AHA, and the Cardiovascular Institute. And with that, I'll be happy to take any questions. Thank you very much. Yeah.
In the two cases you shared with us about the child inheriting a variant in the familial cardiomyopathy that required a heart transplant at an early age, I'm curious, does that reflect a difference, because the parent carried the same variant, so does that reflect a difference in propensity to do heart transplants today versus 25 years ago, or was there a difference in the pathobiology? And to get at that, I guess, have you made iPSC cardiomyocytes from the parents of the same patients?
Yeah. So I think it probably reflects a difference in the pathobiology, less so in terms of how we do heart transplant. In terms of heart transplant, the number of heart transplant essentially has stayed flat around 2,500 cases a year in the U.S. And this is because just lack of a donor pool. I think it's probably pathobiology. And so that particular family is very interesting to us because, as you rightly pointed out, you know, the father has three, the mother has three, and yet nothing happened. And yet, you know, one of the patient, the first two kids, the first one have five, the second one have four, and then they all develop heart failure requiring heart transplant. My hunch is that for some of these variants, for example, it can give you a score. This, again, this is just my hunch, okay? I'm just, you know, I'm making this up as we go along. My hunch is that for some of these variants, it can give you a risk score in which you can have hypertrophy. And if you have two variants, it gives you more. And three variants, it basically tips you over, and over the threshold, you develop a cardiomyopathy. And that's why some of them may have two to three variants and nothing happened, and some of them may have four variants and, you know, they develop the hypertrophy. That's one hypothesis. I don't know, and I don't have a way to prove that. And the only way that we have to prove it's on a iPS cell model is essentially take a isogenic iPS cell, quote unquote normal line, introduce the first variant in, and to see this, do we see hypertrophy on cell morphology? Do we see activation hypertrophic gene response? Introduce a second variant, introduce a third variant, right, and then create a risk score index, very, very similar to the tyrosine kinase inhibitor story that I show you. Yeah.
Right, but you need a fairly short candidate gene list to be introducing each of those.
Yeah.
So back to my question, did you make iPSC cardiomyocytes?
Oh, yeah. So we made iPSC cardiomyocytes from both the parents as well as the five kids. For the parents, we actually don't see much. And for the kids, we actually see the disease. But then we're stuck in terms of, I don't know out of why, you know, which one of these variant in the kids is actually causing the disease phenotype.
Can you do the principal component analysis that you've showed us for your subsequent studies to sort of get at the similarities and differences?
Yeah, so that's one thing we're doing, was essentially introduce one gene, I mean one variant, two, three, and then do, you know, PCA, RNA-seq, and then see, you know, what it looks like. Yeah.
Hi, thank you very much. My question is, I kind of agree with the statement that looking at the phenotypes of the iPSC, of the iPSCs is agnostic, but I think that kind of raises the problem because, first off, there's the bias of knowing the clinical phenotype and then kind of cherry-picking the iPSC phenotype, and then just the sheer complexity of the phenotypes that you're looking at, like hypertrophy versus arrhythmia versus et cetera. So I guess my question is, have you considered doing, I love the idea of the clinical trial that goes from the iPSC to predicting, but you also need, you know, in machine learning terms, you need to train, and then you need to test, and then you can predict. So have you considered doing a clinical trial where you kind of split the cohort in the middle, use half of it to find the diagnostic tools, and then the other half to apply them and see if the prediction works?
Yeah, so we've talked about that, and you know, one of it is using clinical, is using patients with the doxorubicin-induced cardiotoxicity. Essentially, you recruit, for example, you know, 40-year-old woman who have, or under, you probably don't want to recruit the one that are 60 or 70 because they may have other diseases that kind of screws up the picture. But less than 40, breast cancer, divide them into half, and then use the iPSL to see if we can actually predict what happens to the patient or not. That's one cohort. The other cohorts that we talk about is recruiting large numbers of patients with long QT disease, and some of them with genetic long QT, some of them with VUS, and in which the clinicians that are referring the patient to us, it's kind of scratching their head. They're just following the patient. They don't know what to do with it. Follow them for, you know, the next 5 to 10 years, and to be able to see that, you know, for these for a couple of these patients with VUS, we actually see a pretty bad disease phenotype, especially when we challenge them with medications, and you see tons and tons of DADs, EADs compared to the normal patients. And, you know, after 5 years or 10 years, do we see that in the patient cohort as well? So, you know, we're thinking along that line as well. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you. That was a great talk. So, I guess I'm impressed and a little bit surprised that all of your important clinical phenotypes seem to be so beautifully related to cardiomyocytes. Are any of the variants that you've confirmed using your iPSC cardiac cells, do they exhibit altered phenotypes in other iPSC tissue types derived from the same individuals, like metabolism of reactive oxygen species or fat metabolism? Or, I mean, it's hard to believe that all this cardiac disease is really inherent only to the cardiomyocytes and not other.
So I'll answer two ways. So, most of us who work on iPS cells, you'll see in the beginning, all of us cherry pick the monogenic mutations, because these are the big mutations you go after. And once all these big monogenic mutations get out published, then people scramble after the ones that are polygenic mutations. So we, just like others, are now starting to look at diseases, for example, with polygenic mutations. Polygenic causes, and that's why I show you examples of South Asians. I show you examples of African Americans, in which we're looking at the endothelial cells and to see if we could see a difference. Now, the second part to your answer is, do some of these diseases also manifest in the other cell type, for example? It depends on what the mutation is. For example, the myosin heavy chain 7 mutation, that's a pretty cardiac specific mutation. So we see it in iPS cell cardiomyocytes, we don't see it in endothelial cells. I didn't show you the data, but we have, we've been working on LAMA mutation for the past 3 years. And again, these are large cohort families with the LAMA mutation. And for that one, LAMA is involved in cytoskeletal architecture. For that one, we actually see phenotypic changes in both iPSL cardiomyocytes and also quite a bit of phenotypic changes in iPSL endothelial cells. And quite interestingly, clinically, these patients who have LAMA, who was referred to us with LAMA dilated cardiomyopathy, they also have hypertension. So the question is, do the altered nitric oxide release, the altered angiogenesis in the iPS endothelial cells also accounts for the hypertension in these patients?
Thank you.